Hi, this is Tim Burgess, and these are Records in My Life. Nothing yet, but it's us in the world tonight. And purchase for the rescue me.
First of all, tell us about the new album, the title, anyone you've collaborated with, and congratulations on it.
Thank you very much. The new album, I finished it in October last year and was making plans, you know, for it to come out and to go to South by Southwest and to stop off at New York and play the new Colossus Festival. And for it to come out May 22nd. So we stuck to that. We did the New York dates. Obviously, South by Southwest was one of the first festivals to fall prey to COVID-19. All the others have followed suit, and quite rightly so, I imagine. But I never really wanted to move the date, and no one, and it was kind of, it was in motion. So it feels now that it's just a part of what we're all living through. The record is a small or significant part of that. I'm not really sure yet.
Tell us the name of the record. I don't think you mentioned that. And anyone you, who do you collaborate, any collaborators?
Well, the album is called I Love the New Sky. It's an optimistic title.
Yeah.
It was always about thinking about a brighter tomorrow. Collaborators, Aoife Paul Sandra. I don't know whether he's a name to you guys or not, but he is in a band called Coil.
Sure.
He was in a band called Coil. Spiritualized,
of course,
and also Julian Cope, he produced a Peggy Suicide.
Wow.
He was somebody who was on my radar, but didn't realize that he existed at Rockfield Studios, which is an amazing coincidence, because the Charlatans recorded like four or five albums at Rockfield Studios, and I hadn't been back for a long time, but always really wanted to go back. So it was a beautiful thing. Daniel O'Sullivan produced the album. He's in a band called Grumbling Fur, and also a touring member of This Is Not This Heat, who, did some pretty successful shows recently. Rose Keeler Scheffler, who is kind of an underground artist. And Nick Void from Factory Floor.
Nice.
No, techno boffin.
Who've been to Vancouver too?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, and all these collaborators understood what I wanted to do, and helped me realize the dream I had for the songs.
Fantastic. So thank you so much for being on Records of My Life again. The show is about you, the artist, and the albums that have inspired you. I know you're a passionate collector and vast knowledge, hence you have a new show right now that's I'm just looking at some of the lists. You've had like Bell and Sebastian and New Order and Blur, I think, and you've gone back and revisited some great, great, great records. Now, give us a couple. I know I don't want you to do a disservice to bands that have been on your show, but give us a couple of your favorite records that from there.
I'm a big, big fan of Before Today by Ariel Pink's Haunted Graffiti. I love that record. So I was thrilled when Ariel and Tim Coe did that. Flaming Lips, that was quite a beautiful one too. New Order, of course. I'm looking forward to The Cure on the 30th of May.
And which album? Sorry to interrupt you for the cure you do.
Faith.
Oh, nice one. Okay.
Lol Tolhurst talking about that one, which would be great.
Fantastic.
You know, Oasis was a big one, of course. Franz Ferdinand. Got Joy Division tonight.
That okay, so which Joy Division record?
Unknown Pleasures and Peter Hook giving us a track by track run through, hopefully with his bass.
It depends on the mood Hook he is in, right?
Yeah, he's got to be in a good mood.
Is he a moody? Is Hooky a moody? A moody fellow, or?
I would say so. I think, you know, everyone's entitled to be a little bit moody. And, you know, it's part of his image, I think. But he's a lovely guy. Everybody in New Order are lovely people. They're all great.
Very diplomatic. I love that answer.
I mean, it's, you know, they've obviously had some personal things, but, you know, it doesn't,
sure.
It doesn't ever kind of like take away the personal experiences that you've had with each member, and you know, it's like, yeah, whatevs.
now you've been DJing for how many years have you been DJing for?
I've been DJing since 1993.
Yeah, that's a good run. Now, fun question for you. What song always gets the dance, no matter what the occasion, what song always gets the dance floor jumping and moving, or album?
I mean, let's take Blue Monday out of the equation. And here is my, you might remember this one.
Oh, yes, of course.
Come on, Eileen. No matter where you're DJing, whether it's like, you know, sort of like, you know, an indie club, dance club, or whatever. I mean, you know, I don't do techno clubs, but but any kind of like, you know, indie kind of DJing, it's Come On, Eileen. It's just amazing. People love it. They laugh, they smile, they dance. It's, you know, traditional Irish music.
That song was even huge in Canada. That track was, I don't know if it was a number one, but it was huge. And weren't they a punk band too? Like Dexy's Midnight Runner, their music, they started it more as a punk.
I mean, they started in 1978 and they were kind of like more, they looked a bit more Mean Streets, you know, like Skull Caps and sort of, you know, big boots, you know, DMs and kind of like, you know, kind of a Mean Streets kind of look. And then they went and completely changed and just started wearing dungarees and, you know, did the traditional Irish thing. And then they did the Ivy League look after that. So it's like very, very, you know, extreme changes, you know. And for me, they've just always been an amazing band. Not all of their songs would get people on the dance floor, but that one would.
So now you have, once again, like, you know, you have your taste in music and your sounds have changed a lot over the years, from the Charlatans to your personal music. Going back to your youth, what were a couple of the albums that really inspired you to start playing music, to be a front man and to start singing?
I always really like Iggy Pop. Everything from kind of like 5 Foot One, you know, the song 5 Foot One Man Can Do, and I'm Bored, you know, that album, even through to Cold Metal, you know, and he was like one of the first people that I actually had a real open mouth when I met him. I played at Ian Asprey invited the Charlatans to go and play at the Gathering of the Tribes, which was two shows, one in San Francisco and one in Los Angeles. And Iggy Pop played both nights, and he ran up to me and did that on the top of my head and then ran off. And I was just like, oh my God, Iggy Pop just did that to me. That's in fantastic. The kind of room, you know, a kind of communal dressing room that we were all sort of hanging around in. And I was just thinking, how did he, why me? I still don't know whether he was just like, well, he's just messing with me, obviously, but that was an amazing thing. And, you know, but, you know, New Order made me realize that it was possible to be from where I was from and to have a record that was played on the radio. You know, I grew up in a small town in Cheshire, and they were from Macclesfield in Cheshire. They had a club called the Hacienda in Manchester, which was like, you know, 20 miles from where I was living. You know, they had a hit that was big in New York and you know, obviously worldwide, but, you know, they just kept going on about New York. And living in Cheshire, you just think, oh my God, what a cool place New York sounds, you know. And it just made me really want to pursue it even more, you know. That was 16. Iggy Pop was before New Order.
Right, right. Yeah, Iggy's had an incredible career, right? He started in the 70s. I mean, that's long, and he still looks amazing when you look at him. The guy's, you know.
He really does. I mean, and, you know, every band learns I Want to Be Your Dog, you know, yeah. Every band. And it's just such a great song, but such a great one for kids to learn.
And he seems to... It's true. It is. It's a great, I mean, whether you understand that as a child, the meaning of that song is a different story, but Iggy seems like the complete, like, he seems like a complete affable, I forget who it was, but someone was talking to us saying that, yeah, I met Iggy and all he could do was ask us about our band. Like he's got like no ego, like whatsoever. He's kind of like.
And he loves that. He loves Sleaford Mods, doesn't he, at the moment? That's his big thing.
That's who it was. It was Sleaford Mods. I'm sorry. Yes, that's right, because we had them on the show. Thank you. Thank you very much. That's great.
Well, I know Jason. Well, I know them both, but, you know, Jason's just like, he just loves it.
Right. So here's another fun question. If you could be a fly on the wall for any album being recorded in the history of rock and roll.
Yeah, history of rock and roll. Wow. I don't know. Maybe Goat's Head Soup. I mean, I don't know why I really like that record. I love all the Stones records, but Goat's Head Soup, I just want to know more about it. It seems like a mysterious one to me. That my favorite song by them is Winter. You know, the song about, you know, it's like the lights in California, and, you know, it's just like a gorgeous, gorgeous song. And I want to know more about it and what was going on. And it just seems very mysterious to me.
We like to pride ourselves on educating people about new music or old music. Give us a recent discovery of yours that is absolutely, like I said, it can be an old artist or a newer artist. That's absolutely you've become obsessed with.
Yeah, I've kind of become a little bit obsessed with 10cc and sheet music in particular. I didn't really. I've had the Charlatans have had videos directed by Kevin Godley, but I never really listened to anything more than "I'm Not in Love" by 10cc. And when I was recording my album, a couple of people had mentioned that it had a similar sound in some ways to some of 10cc stuff. And I was like, yeah, well, I don't really know. So I just went and bought the album and really, really, really love it now. So it's kind of a beautiful connection. I mean, if there's any new, I love new artists. Aoife Nessa Frances, we had on the listening party the other day at 8 o'clock. She's from Ireland. I met her a couple of years ago. The Charlatans were playing a festival in the southern part of Ireland, and I went to like the Cove where she grew up, and she was playing me her album, and I just thought, this is amazing. I really got a backstory of what her record was like. So it's Aoife, it's Aoife, Nessa, as in short for Vanessa. And then Francis. And it's just a gorgeous album. I really wanted to put it out on my label, but somebody else did it, and they did a really good job. So I'm kind of glad that they did it, and it's getting quite big now. You know, some in Mojo and all that kind of stuff in the UK. So
terrific. Thanks again for being on the show. A couple more quick questions. I know you're a busy family man, record label, DJ. You got your album coming. We like to ask all our guests, weed, wine, or water, to write or to listen to your favorite album.
Well, I have to now drink water because I stopped drinking in 2006. And
that's amazing.
I had to stop drinking a lot, really. I mean, nobody said that I had to, but I kind of knew that I had to, and I stopped. So it's water and wheat. I don't really know what wheat is.
That's a good answer. You have a child. That's a terrific answer. I'm proud of you. We'll go back to coffee. I know it's probably your favorite beverage. So coffee with an artist, alive or dead?
I would love to. Are you familiar with Graham Parsons?
Sure.
Yeah. I like him. I like him. I've always liked him. I've liked him for so many years. Sort of 1993, again. I think I mentioned that date twice on your show now, but that was the first time I heard of Graham Parsons, and you know, the whole of the UK was Britpop crazy, and I was listening to a guy from Florida from the mid 60s singing country songs.
He's a mystery, right? Because he grew up in Florida, but he went to Harvard, right? And
he did. It was very an intellect, absolutely, you know. And ended up in LA in the Birds, and then kind of like changed the direction and sound and everything, even I think the politics within the Birds. And then, you know, Flamburrito Brothers, and then his two solo albums, Emmylou Harris, just gorgeous voice. You know, so powerful, you know.
Yeah, I mean, he tremendous influence on the alt country. He might have been like Flying Burrito Brothers, might have started that whole Uncle Tupelo, Wilco, Sunvolt type of alt country thing. I'm guessing. I don't know. You would know better than me.
No, I agree. I agree completely. And, you know, and I love Graham. I love the nudie suits. He's like, you know, as glam as Jagger. I think he influenced Keith Richards, you know, quite a lot.
And a really handsome, the story is so sad because a beautiful guy that died, it's a talented guy that died at such a young age. You know, he couldn't keep up with Keith. That was the, Well, nobody could keep up with Keith, but you know, what would you consider the song if you're going back to your youth? You're still a young man, but what would the song of your generation? What would you, going back to your school days, that you remember the first song or band that comes to your mind?
Well, a couple have come to my mind. Kraftwerk, because of the song Model. Beastie Boys, because of Fight for Your Right to Party. Spirit of the Radio by Rush.
Nice.
I'm always happy when people bring up Canadian content, you know.
There you go.
It's lovely.
I mean, everybody liked Rush at our school, you know. It was just, but I just like the hit.
That's incredible. I'm quite, because a lot of people either love Rush, you know, like, or you just don't, because you know, they're a different style. It's a very, their music's very involved.
Yeah, it's complex, you know. I mean, they had hits in the UK.
Amazing. We like to ask all our guests finally for some words of wisdom for their fans and our audience.
Wow, you're asking me?
Yes, sir.
Well, allow your spirit to be on show. That's what I say. I've just lost my dad, and I was trying.
Sorry.
Oh,
Sorry for that.
Thank you so much. Yeah. But you know, it was a long time, a long process. Yeah. And I was just trying to explain to my little boy, you know, about that his body has left us, but his spirit will always be there. And he was saying, "What's the spirit?" And I'm just trying to show him with the use of my arms, I think. And he's now using his spirit. And it normally involves like standing in the middle of a room just doing that. But I think he gets, you know, I think he gets the overall idea of it, that it's, you know, just being yourself and be spirited and enjoy what, you know, the good things, you know.
Sir, thanks so much, and have a great time with your son and your partner or wife, and good luck with the new record.
And looking forward to seeing you out in Vancouver one of these days.
I can't wait. I really can't wait. I mean, you know, hopefully when we start. I mean, I've got a 3-year visa. There you go.
All right. Thanks again. And look forward, as I say, hopefully we'll see you out here soon. Peace.
Take care, man. Peace.
Talk to you. Bye.
See you later. Bye.
Bye.
Hi, I'm Mark Henning, the other half of Records in My Life. Love it that you made it to the end of the video. Please leave us a comment, leave us a thumbs up, and subscribe. If you really dug the show, we'd love it if you'd consider supporting us over at patreon.com/RIMLTV. Cheers, and see you next week.